So I was very impressed yesterday. I'm very happy to be here. Lots of fun. I attended as many communications as I could, half of them. I was impressed especially yesterday with the panel for the young participants. I'm very sad they are not here because they are going to be appraised. But they were very organized. 1, 2, 3, 4. Because they are starting. They are doing their PhDs. I did my PhD already, so I can be disorganized. So I'm not going to read the paper, but just showing a bit of this. So the art of the deal. Actually, I have two main points in my communication. And my talk, one is creative writing is not about creativity. Second, science fiction, the one that interests me is political fiction, mainly. And there's nothing, not much of science, but you do what you can do what with the tools you have. So the art of the deal, I just wanted to have the same title of the only book Trump wrote and read, as the title for a scientific communication, and I managed. So the art of the deal I stole from Donald Trump. And when I start teaching creative writing in Portugal, and it was by then, everybody asked the same question, can you teach talent? Can you teach creativity? And that was, I always felt that it was very dishonest from the people who argued. My revenge is that now they are all teaching creative writing. The same ones who 30 years ago thought it was despicable thing. So it's a tiny revenge, but it is, because it's people get by teaching creative writing. And I actually think that people get by enrolling in a creative writing class. You don't even have to enroll. I don't think of a single writer across the centuries that didn't enroll in a creative writing class. Camões, the Portuguese one, started by imitating Petrarca, as did Shakespeare with his sonnets. You learn by translating, you learn by watching, you learn by tinkering. That's how you learn things. And I always think that with piano, if people had the same expectation they have towards literature, towards writing, that they have towards music, it would be great. Like Mozart never saw a piano and suddenly he goes and starts composing wonderful stuff or painting. No, in these arts, you expect people to learn the trade. But with writing, you always have this thing that you don't need. It's a little bit suspicious to learn the trade, and because it's about inspiration. And I actually think nowadays many people write in order not to read. So a creative writing class is mainly, it doesn't turn you into a better writer. It turns you into a better reader. And this, as Oulipo in France, international group based in France, Ouvroir de littérature potentielle, workshop for potential literature in the 60s, they did a very interesting thing, which was not to try to be creative, but to try not to be creative. And this sounds stupid, but if you see the names of the guys who were in this group, you realize that they are like pillars for the 20th century. And for the 21st century, Italo Calvino, Raymond Queneau, Georges Perec, and so on and so on. And what they did is applying either constraints, either cybernetics, apply, like, instead of saying, try to slogans like think out of the box, no, try to solve this problem. Descalça a bota. It's a wonderful metaphor. I'm sorry, Kim, you have to learn Portuguese in order to understand it, but it's worse, because it's a wonderful expression, descalça a bota. How am I going to solve this? So we do what we can. It's not about the story. It's about what you do about the story. You tell it the way you can, not the way you want. You have the world in front of you if you read. You can go from 19th century Russia to space or Mars, but as a writer, if you want to be a serious writer, you find out that you are very limited in the things you can actually talk about. Like Raymond Carver would put it, you talk about what you can talk about. And then you narrow and narrows and narrows. Arguably, one of the greatest books for the 20th century is The Metamorphosis by Kafka, which is the Gregor Samsa woke up realizing he was turned into a bug. Gregor Samsa, he made it clear that it's him, Kafka Samsa. And it's actually not an imaginary imagination book. It's a very stupid, it's a very dumb story. He woke up, turned into a bug, and then what happens? And what you see is that he just have to get by. He doesn't ask, how am I going to become human again? He asks himself, how am I going to work? I have to work. I have to be at work at 9. How am I going to take the subway? That is his question, and that is so modern. And he's talking. By then, it looked like imaginary, but it was visionary. He was not seeing the future. It's very stupid to say you see the future. Nobody sees the future. Science fiction always has its feet stuck on the present. We live the present. But he could see ahead. If I'm on the top floor, I can see farther than if I'm on the ground floor. So he was just sniffing, using his nose to sniff what was coming soon. The turning of humans, and specifically of Jewish humans in Prague, Berlin, and so on, into bugs, into the dehumanization of people. So it was a very, very plain book. Now, Kurt Vonnegut, he and this is Slaughterhouse 5, if you didn't read, please do, and Dispossessed by Ursula Le Guin, they are incredible, incredible books. Slaughterhouse 5, he took Kurt Vonnegut like 20 years to write it. It didn't take him 20 years to write, it took him 20 years to find out how to write this book. And it came out very short book, like 120 pages. And he had been a science fiction writer, and then he, in order to become a real writer, it was told yesterday about the talking session, where Rosario was, he in order to be respected as a writer, he felt that he should stop doing science fiction. And he actually wanted to talk about something very serious that had happened to him. So a writer sometimes is someone that is a witness. He or she may not be a good witness, but it's the person that was there. It's like if there is an accident, the police comes and say, who saw the accident? And they say, me. And they say, you are not qualified as a witness. We would like someone better than you, better looking, younger, or whatever. But then they found no one there. They find no one there. So, okay, we'll use you as a witness. So Kurt Vonnegut was one of the few survivors of the Dresden bombing. And the Dresden bombing was a bombing by the good guys against the bad guys. It was pointless. There was no military Nazis there. There were only civilians. It was pure revenge. It was pure evil. But it was done by the good guys. And of course, the Nazis, the Germans deserved it. Come on, we can talk about the elephant in the room. But, you know, did those specific people deserve it? Because terrorism is when I try to harm person A, and I can't harm person A, so I harm person B. For me, that's the very definition of terrorism. So, even bombing the bad guys can be a bad thing. And he didn't know how to deal with that until he found out that he needed the tools from his old days, when he was not respectable, in order to approach that very real thing, in order to talk about his experience as Dresden survivor, as an American prisoner. The joke is on him. He is a German-American who was an American soldier prisoner on a German city. And he's one of the few survivors. And he found out that he had to talk about that the way he could. So now Ursula Le Guin, she's a different. They are contemporary. All the people I'm talking about now are in the 1960s, 1970s, these works. This is from 74. I think Slaughterhouse is from 1969. But now I would like to show you something else. So this is now the entertaining moment. I'm going to start with the funniest part. Okay, so just comic relief. I'm very annoyed with this scene because this is from Mary Poppins, and the time of the story it's 1910, like 15 years before women's vote, but in the suffragette movement, and this is funny. This is ridiculous. This woman, she can't actually take care of her children. She's very unreliable. She's very laughable. She's ridiculous. She's a galinha, and it's laughable. And I can picture London by then. You could go to a theater and making fun of the suffragette. Mm-hmm. But we know nowadays that it's quite a serious matter, and you know nowadays that the joke was on them. That this is like many other things nowadays not accepted. So what happened is that this movie was made in 1964. So by then, Walt Disney decided to do a story for children, no gender ideology here, where you make fun of women's votes. This is Disney for me. It's like the very definition of Disney, always a little bit behind the curve, like the guys who believe that the Earth is plain. So at the same time, you had The Dispossessed by Ursula Le Guin. And Ursula Le Guin, she actually did the opposite. She created here not a dystopia, which is very uncommon for the last 50 years. She created a utopia, and it's like two planets, and in one planet, finally, after some decades of fight and imprisonment, they let a few thousand anarchists go to that planet. So they live in a planet that is very much like Dune, starving, but they are free. And they are free, and it's a feminist novel. It's a novel that she's not an anarchist, Le Guin, but she is actually in this book like saying, what if anarchism worked? And she's also, because she's not writing a Disney book, she's also creating problems. It's not actually a real utopia. It's not really that wonderful. But it shows differences, and then some scientists from that planet comes to this planet, and this planet is very much like America, Soviet Union. By the time there is even Vietnam and wars in Africa, and it's like a criticism. It's actually a very old thing. It's like the Indian or the Japanese, Native American or Japanese, that goes and confronts the West with its ideas, its foul ideas. And it's a very old thing. Actually, Kurt Vonnegut and Ursula Le Guin are both anthropologists. And they were both teachers and students of creative writing. Now, this has nothing to do with that, but I have a golden heart. Everybody knows that I have a wonderful heart. So this is a story. This is a story. After a while, if you can leave me or like 2 euros to help the children, I will be grateful. But this is a true story. Tilly Smith, she saved in December in 2004. She was with her family, with her parents in a beach in Thailand when the tsunami came. Tsunami that killed hundreds of thousands of people. And she actually saved her family. And for me, this is the seven points miracle event. One, she was attentive in class. She saved people because in her class of geography and biology, her teacher told her what were the signs of tsunami. Nazism is Kafka. And she actually was attentive in class. Miracle one. Miracle two, she remembered what she learned. Miracle three, she applied what she learned. Miracle four, her parents believed her. Miracle five, they acted upon it, which is they fled. Miracle six, they warned others. And miracle seven, they survived. What does this have to do with creativity? Well, she's now 25. I don't know what she's studying, but she helped save like 100 people at least. And at least one of those 100 people wrote a poem. So that's creativity for you. She saved lives. And that's the most creative act that can be. And she's still alive, and that's wonderful. We need people like her. Now, for something completely different, if you go to Lisbon, I hope you go to Lisbon. I know the next year it's Porto, but please go to Lisbon. Because in Lisbon you can see this wonderful subway. We are so fucking proud of this subway. I mean, like, you go to the some people said that the subway was created only to gave more value to the land place of the airport because it's moving elsewhere. But I'm a believer. So this is like a monument to the people. This is our Stalin subway. This is our palace for the people. And what happens is that you arrive, you are a foreigner, you arrive to the airport, and don't go to the taxis, they will rob you blind, but you go down and you take the underground, and in 20 minutes you are in the city. It's great. And you see this wonderful corridor with nearly full size, like a person size, caricatures, cartoons by a great artist, Antonio, of important people in Portugal. And important people in Portugal were like across 8 centuries. It's a very old country. But the thing, this was made in 2012, in the 21st century. And in the 21st century, you arrive and you see all the quality or the marble, you see how great we are. And they forgot to hire, I don't know, Ursula K. Le Guin for 50 euros. She was still alive. She will do it. Or Kurt Vonnegut for 100 years. Men are always more expensive. Or me for 5 euros. There are plenty of anthropologists or cultural critics or writers or people who think a little bit in Portugal. And nobody realized they built this thing. Nobody realized that this is a gallery of men with the odd woman once in a while. And then some people say, oh, come on, you see evil everywhere. These are the people that are important. Okay, you are a foreigner. Can you recognize any one of these idiots? You can't. Not even Portuguese can. Most Portuguese cannot recognize who this guy is or that guy is. This guy's name, I'm sure here nearly nobody knows who this guy is. Maybe Cotinelli Telmo, maybe the huh? Okay. No, it's not Vitorino Mezzi. No, this is the guy. This is the guy who built the Diário de Notícias. See, see. Okay. So this is a gallery of guys, and there are plenty of women, important women. Like we had the prime minister in 1980s. She was one of the first person to run for president in the whole world, a woman, and she got 8%. I voted for her. And it's not here. You have plenty of people that could be here. You have plenty of people that did need to be here, but it was normal. And this, in 2012, does exactly the opposite of what it expected to do. So it will be those 50 euros will be good sound money. This is nearly as ridiculous as Mary Poppins, where they make, not in the book, in the movie, they make fun of the suffragette. They make fun of these stupid women who want to vote. Stupid feminists. I hate them. Okay. Sorry. Sometimes. Okay. So I just want to show you a little bit more, a couple of movies, and we are done. And this is just, this is wonderful because this is from Solaris. It's one of the great science fiction novels, and it's also a political philosophical novel. It's about a planet that is God of itself, a planet that is one single intelligence. And this guy is in the future, like 22nd century. For 100 years, we've arrived to this planet, Solaris, and this guy is a cosmonaut, and he's going to fly to that planet. So they have to make a scene. Tarkovsky, in 1969, he has to shoot a scene of the future, a city in the future. And so he decides to shoot a car driving. It's great. It's like one single shot, okay? This is the future. It's a Russian movie, as you know, Soviet film, and they are in the future. It's incredible. See? It's the future. And the guy goes in the car. Okay, so as you can see, this is the Tarkovsky. He wanted to go to the film the future, and the thing is that how can he film? You don't have CGI by then. He doesn't have money. So what he does is he does what Vonnegut tells in the Slaughterhouse 5, where you have the Trafamadorian. So the guy, it's a book about Dresden, but he uses this technique of there are these Trafamadorians who take this guy to this planet, and they tell us that time is a landscape. Time is not after. It's like if you pick the pages of the book and you put them, you can do that actually, you split them like 200 pages and you put them all over and you can read them all at once. The future is written, as in old Muslim saying, the future is written, but actually if the future is written, we can use the future to read the past. It's the past that is not written. So what happens here is that he travels to the future, and the future is Tokyo. So some of you may recognize, some of you may see the signs. This is a taxi, typical taxi from Tokyo. And I could only recognize this when I went to Tokyo, 30 years after seeing this movie. So I was like, wow, this is really the future. For a guy from Moscow, it was the future. Okay? And I really love this idea. Okay, so these are like, it's just, this is from this process. What a man wants is freedom. What a woman wants is property. She only let you go if she can't trade you for something else. All women are proprietarians. So this is a guy in that utopia showing that you have idiots even in utopia. That's a hell of a thing to say about half the human race. And it goes on. And he has this beautiful thing in the bottom here. I think most men mostly have to learn to be anarchists. Women don't have to learn. And you know that anarchist is not a guy who puts bombs. An anarchist is a guy, a person, that doesn't need order external because you don't litter, you don't harm others because you don't do that. Because you were raised not to do that. You were raised to be polite. That's what anarchism as an utopia is. Being polite to everybody. Don't abuse anyone. So, we Trafmaldorians, you can see here, we Trafmaldorians read them all at once, not after the other. So, past, present, and future for the Trafmaldorians is everything is the same. Okay, so this is like a warning. And I like very much the movie Arrival, where he picks an idea from Vonnegut, and there is a nuclear physicist, a male, snorts and asks the linguistics woman to ask the squid-looking aliens big important questions. How did they space travel? What sort of cabaret did you use? Did you time warp? And annoyed, the woman says, the linguist, wait, I first have to learn how they say hello. It's incredible because it's the first American film where you have someone from humanities and that person is more important than the guys from physics and all the hard stuff. So these are some musical themes for the 21st century, if there are any writers or poets in the room. Dehumanization, memory, gain with the computers and loss with sort of Alzheimer, collective Alzheimer. Outsourcing everything. Overpopulated world, robots, when will they trump us? Not how, but when. Class struggle. I think CEOs are now making a lot of money because they know something that we don't. Because this is something new. 50 years ago, lawyers and doctors and CEOs, they made the same money. Now it completely changed. And pollution, and at the bottom, yes. Fascism. I think it's a good subject for the 21st century. So, be a funny Kafka, Kim. We were talking about that yesterday. And despair better, fail better, fail better. And now I leave you with a wonderful movie from, this is really the end. It's a beautiful song. And a wonderful movie from 2 years ago, Valerian. And you'll see who just compare, think about the leader of the humans and how across the centuries things change, how this movie expresses without wanting, talking about the future, talks about the its shortcomings, so talks about nowadays. See, okay. This is crown.
Planet Kingdom, Planet Hunter, Planet Black, Planet Blackness, Planet Chinese, Japanese. They are weird. Focus on the leader of the human race. This is the opening scene for the 15th one. Okay, now it's getting weird.
Space station has reached critical mass in order.
And guy, okay, you have to, it's an homage to Rutger Hauer, but it could be an homage, I don't know, to Sigourney Weaver. The leader of the human race across the centuries is always a guy. I rest my case. Thank you.